Belinda presents this unabridged recording of My Mother Warned Me About Blokes Like Me, Motorcycle Stories of Brotherhood, Demons, Dirt and Danger. Written by Boris Mihailovic and read by Dave Ferguson. For my beloved wife Lynette and my wonderful son Andrew, thanks for putting up with the anguished screaming inherent in my creative process. Introduction. I can no more stop riding motorcycles than I can stop breathing. I am far worse than any toothless crackhead or wee-stained smack freak when it comes to servicing this addiction. Believe it. If I had to climb through your window in the middle of the night and steal your kids' fluffy toys, or your kids for that matter, and hock them for petrol or tyres so I could go riding the next day, I would. Of course, there have been times when the law has decreed that for my sins against the Motor Traffic Act, I would not be permitted to ride upon a public road for a certain length of time. Did that stop me riding? Did it shit? As soon as I could organise it, I'd be lurching wildly through the nearest scrub on some barking dirt bike full of hate, or cartwheeling it down some scree-strewn precipice, as my internal organs rearranged themselves in horror. Hell, I once decided I needed to go motorcycle racing after one particularly long and stressful period on the sidelines, a decision which promptly served me up several broken ribs, scared a steamy kilo of excrement out of me, and made my dumb middle-aged head ring like a Chinese gong for a week after I face-planted on turn 11 at Eastern Creek Raceway, on lap one no less. Certainly, various injuries and illnesses have prevented me from riding for brief periods of time. But these enforced pauses have always been nothing but short commercial breaks in the ongoing motorcycling soap opera that is my life. And that soap opera is pretty much what this book is all about. The stories on the following pages span three decades of riding. And while they are by no means all the stories I could tell, they do provide a good indication of what happens when one sells one's soul to the blessed bastard motorcycle in all of its many incarnations. Are the stories true? Well, of course they are. A man couldn't make this shit up. Except for the bits that could otherwise see me doing lengthy jail time. Those bits are entirely fictional. Honestly, cross my heart, Your Honour. A few of the yarns would be vaguely familiar to regular readers of my column in Australian Motorcycle News. But so as not to damage the almost childlike sensibilities of some of its readers, I chose to leave out or change various segments of those tales. The salty, angst-filled tears of the magazine's editors were always a good indication of what they were uncomfortable with. You might be pleased to know that those parts have now been put back in. My mum will not share in your pleasure. I'm not even sure I wanted to read this book. You see, my mum really believes that one day I shall come to my senses and stop riding these wretched, stupid, and improbably perilous motorcycles. She has believed this since the first day I started riding them more than 30 years ago. It's a constant in our relationship. Every time she sees me, she asks me if I'm still riding bikes. I tell her I am. She frowns and advises me yet again that they're very dangerous. Because I love her, I refrain from telling her that that is exactly what attracts people like me to motorcycles in the first place. Instead, I lie to her and assure her that I'm always careful. I know she doesn't believe me, but I tell her anyway. The uncomfortable truth is that I actually came to my senses the day I started riding bikes. I so very much came to my senses, it was simply not possible to come to them in any greater degree. All the senses there ever were for me to come to had been arrived at on that fateful day, and the ensuing decades of riding have only served to confirm that arrival. Of course, it is entirely possible that riding motorcycles has driven me completely insane. I have no way of knowing, since everyone I happen to be good friends with is as deeply obsessed with riding motorcycles as I am. But in this very ignorance lies my bliss. Either way, to know about any of this is completely surplus to my mum's requirements. So please don't tell her. Thanks. And while I'm dispensing gratitude, I'm very grateful to my boss, Peter Holder, at ACP Magazines, whose professionalism, reassurance and tolerance has always been an inspiration. I must also thank my friends, Nick and Clavdy, Without whose cruel and searing encouragement, I'd still be scratching my ass and wondering what to write about, when the answer was always staring me in the face. "Write about what you know, stupid," they said to me at various times. And so I did, and this is the result. I hope you get as much of a kick out of reading it as I did living it. But I somehow doubt that. Boris. A Man Called GRONK. Every serious addiction has a definable beginning. Every junkie worth his scabby track marks recalls the first time he felt the fanged kiss of a syringe. But once motorcycling gets into your veins, the need to ride makes the hankering for heroin feel like a mild craving for something with chocolate in it. The syringe full of my addiction began to fill in the early 70s when I started reading magazines like Australian Motorcycle News, Revs, and Two Wheels. My father worked in the printing industry, and alongside copies of the Australian Women's Weekly and the Bulletin he'd bring home each month, there'd be the odd motorcycle magazine. He also brought home copies of the iconic surfing magazine Trax. But while I liked the bikini ads and the Captain Good Vibes cartoon, the chances of a tubby, badly myopic wog kid named Boris ever carving the glassy break at South Bondi was slim. I also started to read the American biker bible Easy Riders. Initially attracted to the tits on its pages, I stayed for the motorcycles and for the incredibly vivid fiction stories by writers like Jody Vyer and illustrations by the legendary Dave Mann. The bike magazines spoke to me in a voice promising everything a teenage male wants: adventure, rebellion, camaraderie, speed, danger, and girls who would suck your dick for beer. So by the time I grew some proper pubic hair, the motorcycle syringe was full, the rubber hose was around my arm, and the pulsing vein was evident. All that remained was the prick and the plunge. To know what you prefer instead of humbly saying amen to what the world tells you you ought to prefer is to have kept your soul alive. Robert Louis Stevenson. It would be fair to say I owe my entire desperate motorcycle fetish to a man called GRONK. And may the road gods bless him and keep him from harm. All 130 marijuana-enriched kilos of him. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Unlike many motorcyclists, I did not learn to ride bikes in the great outdoors. I was a city kid. I learned to ride them in the back streets of inner Sydney's Camperdown, an altogether incredible and disturbing feat when viewed through the prism of today's nanny state fascism. But in the 70s, the world was a very different place. People gave less of a shit back then. A bunch of kids buggering about on noisy motorcycles was not all that uncommon. And it was beneath the dignity of the cops to do anything more about it than kick the juveniles in the arse and send them home. I think most kids in those days knew someone or knew someone who knew someone who had a motorcycle. Most of us played in the streets all the time. And what growing boy isn't going to look with desire upon a fast, loud, engine-y thing with handlebars? A motorised extension of the pushbike he was riding every day. It all began for me the day a 17-year-old man called GRONK arrived at my school one glorious lunchtime astride a noisy, oil-splashed XL250 Honda. As I was struggling through fourth form, year 10 in today's money, and puberty. To be perfectly honest, it had actually started some years prior to GRONK's oily advent in the Fort Street High School car park. But motorcycling didn't really sink its greasy fangs into my soul until that day. I'd ridden a few times before. For example, I'd ridden a mini bike into a tree as a child at a picnic ground near the Colo River. It made my mother cry and slapped me upside the head. So I didn't essay motorcycle riding again until I was about 12, when I managed to talk a friend's heavily stoned older brother into letting me scrape his Z900 Kawasaki and my thigh along his neighbour's front fences for about 20 metres. He cried and slapped me upside the head too. But by the time GRONK turned up, the scars had healed, and I was at that awkward age when everything from sniping cats with slug guns to wrestling pythons in vats of porridge seemed like a good idea. The siren song of motorcycles would find a receptive listener in me. GRONK wasn't a student at my school, but he was mates with one of my mates who was a student, and GRONK had brought his bike along to show him. Our little four-man posse of teenage proto-criminals immediately surrounded him as he sat astride this proper man-sized bike in the school car park, blipping the throttle and out-cooling every cool thing I'd ever imagined. "Giz a go!" I screeched unthinkingly, convinced I'd never get one. But I was a little maddened by the smell of burning oil and exhaust fumes. "Can you ride?" he asked. A fair question, given Gronk didn't know me very well. "Yeah," I lied, fully aware that a detailed rundown of how I crashed a two-stroke rockhopper into a tree 6 years before was clearly not what Gronk would want to hear at this pivotal moment. He shrugged and got off. I had a quick look around to see if there were any teachers nearby, and got on. My toes could barely touch the ground, and the bike felt vast. It was hot, too, and seriously heavier than I'd imagined. Suddenly, I was a little scared. My mates all stood around me, honking and giggling and keeping a lookout for teachers, so there was no question of a change of heart. In the eyes of my peers, a back down would be tantamount to admitting your preferred kissing boys. It was a ride-or-die moment. I revved it. Nothing happened. "Put it in first," Gronk instructed. Easy for him to say. I had a vague notion he was talking about gears, but none at all about where they might be found. "Hold the clutch in," he demanded, tapping helpfully on the lever. I duly pulled it in and held it. He kicked the bike into first for me, via a small lever near the left foot peg, and I felt the Honda lurch a bit. "Now give it some revs and let the clutch out slowly." And that was pretty much that, as far as my riding lesson went. It also pretty much sealed the deal on the sale of my soul to the infernal two-wheeler. I was doomed before I'd even pogoed madly out of the car park and onto the street, helmetless and in school uniform. An instant and irredeemable motorcycle tragic. World without end. Amen. I couldn't sleep that night. I'd never got the bike out of first gear. Stalled it 100 times and ripped open my leg kickstarting it 101 times. But something profound had occurred inside my head in the hour I'd spent riding Gronk's bike in the streets behind my high school. And it was playing on a constant loop as I lay awake in my bed. The sheer atavistic rush of speed that only a motorcycle can provide is so addictive it makes crack cocaine look like a bitch. The incomparable coolness, rebelliousness, and pure otherness of being a motorcyclist, albeit one dressed in a school uniform, spoke to my puberty in a language as old as mankind itself. And I listened. Oh, how I listened. The next morning, I was sand-eyed with lack of sleep, but my mind was clear and focused. I was not the same 15-year-old kid who went to bed the night before, leaking blood from his Kickstarter gouged leg and smelling of burnt fossil fuel. I was now a motorcyclist. Luckily, my schoolmates were dedicated truants and dope smokers and would visit Gronk, who had happily eschewed school altogether by having been expelled from every educational possibility in a 25-kilometre radius of where he lived, at least 3 times a week. I'd rarely gone with them, not because jigging school bothered me, but because I didn't smoke dope back then, and Gronk's house was a veritable shrine to that pastime. So you can imagine the big fella's surprise when I fronted there the very next day. Gronk apparently lived with his parents in a large house just off Parramatta Road in Camperdown. I say apparently because I'd never met his oldies. The only evidence they even existed were 3 stunningly pornographic photos of them Gronk had discovered in their bedroom one day and shared with us. Such was his immense generosity and magnanimity of spirit, and it was that very generosity and magnanimity I was counting on as I climbed over his back fence. As usual, security was tight. The back door was wide open, and Gronk and my mates were happily lazing about his smoke-wreathed lounge room, discussing the benefits of chillums as opposed to joints, when I appeared in the doorway. "Changed your mind about a smoke?" he grinned, proffering me a crackling 7-paper bunger. Actually I was wondering if I could have another go on your bike." Gronk peered at me through bloodshot Chinese eyes for a bit. He may have been demandingly stoned, but he was not stupid. He knew I couldn't ride worth a shit, and was obviously considering the implications of what would happen if I crashed and burned. "If you wreck it, you gotta fix it," he finally said, and handed me the key. "You can borrow my helmet if you want." I grinned my thanks and bolted out to where the XL250 was parked in the garage. There was no fear in me today. My hour of power yesterday had annealed me and flushed the trepidation from my glands. Even my Kickstarter-kissed leg was ready for more action. Teenagers heal like only teenagers can, which is handy given how batshit crazy most of them are. One sniff of Gronk's white bell helmet convinced me I would be much better off without it, and I clumsily wheeled the bike into the lane behind his house. My legs still ached, but not enough to prevent me kicking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.